Hey, everybody. Welcome to Wednesday night. Well, if you're watching live, which you're not, so forget I said anything. It's Ham Nation time. That's what it is. No matter what time it is where you are, it's Ham Nation time here. And we have got a fascinating show. We are going to pull the wraps back and see inside amateur television, specifically ATN, the Amateur Television Network. This is fascinating. These guys are gung-ho, and I mean, they are chin deep in amateur television. And after you see this, you're going to want to jump in the pool too. And they say, come on in, the water's fine. We're going to have Amanda with the chat room. We're going to have Newsline, a little bit of information from Dr. T. And George is going to show us an alternative to shrink wrap. You're not going to want to miss this. It's all coming up right now here on Ham Nation. Ham Nation is brought to you from LastPass Studios. You're focused on security, but are your employees? LastPass can ensure that they are by making access and authentication seamless. Visit LastPass.com/twit to learn more.
Podcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
This episode of Ham Nation is brought to you by ICOM. For more information, visit icomamerica.com/hamnation.
This is Ham Nation, episode number 443 for March 4th, 2020. All about amateur television. Hey, good evening. It's Wednesday night. That is if you're watching live, and that means it's Ham Nation night, as it has been for the last 8 years. Can you believe that? Wow, we've been at this a while, and one of these days we'll get it right. Dr. Bob is out tonight, probably doing some manner of house call. So the rest of the crew, who I like to refer to as the unindicted co-conspirators, are here. We've got George Thomas right up there to the top. We've got Gordon West right over there to the other side. And Gordon has Roland, who is with ATV, will be getting a big thing from Roland Hoffman. Going to tell you all about amateur television tonight. We'll have Amanda with the chat room and Dr. Scove. We'll have some information from her. She won't be here, but we'll have some solar information from her and a report from Newsline and all kinds of cool stuff, too. So, George, how are you tonight? Are you guys getting wet from the rain? We got some pretty good rain today.
We did, too, and we're still getting some here. It's, you know, I think they said on the news last week that through February we had had half a year's worth of rain here. So Wow. It has been extremely wet this whole year, and boy, it's still coming down out there. So I don't know, Don, you may have to throw me a rope a little later on in the show if you just put it in my hand and that's all you see.
Well, I was beginning to think that you would have to throw me one because you had all that rain up there the last couple of weeks. And, of course, Jackson, Mississippi had a lot of flooding up there as well. Well, all that water finally made it down here to the Pearl River. And we had like 18 feet, which is about 4 feet above flood stage. But it's starting to recede now, which is a good thing. And, of course, we want to bear in mind our good friends up in the Nashville area. Horrendous tornadoes up in Nashville last night and early this morning, so we're thinking about them. So you guys, we have you in our prayers. Want to tell you about a Hamfest real quick coming up in our neck of the woods, George and me, the Pine Belt Hamfest in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. That is coming up this weekend. I guess if you just search Pine Belt Hamfest 2020, you'll find out all the information you need to know about that. But going to be a good time, and I'm going to go up there, and hopefully George will be able to find his way down south to that one. Should be a pretty good one. Over on the West Coast, we've got Gordon West. How are you doing tonight, sir?
We are doing fine. Thanks, John. And I want to remind everybody, in your neck of the woods, the ARRL Texas State Convention coming up at the Greater Houston Ham Fest and Innovation Spark. It's a big get-together on March 7th. this Saturday, and Greater Houston Ham Fest is really going to do a great job. We've seen all the planning that they're putting in on it, and it'll be big. And then a week from tonight, Limark, the Long Island Mobile Amateur Radio Club, they have their Member Appreciation Night. It's their 55th anniversary. I've been there for Limark several times. It is a terrific group. Sad news, Paul McIntyre with the River City Amateur Radio Communications Society, KC5JAX out here in California, has lost his life. And we're so sorry to hear that, because he was a driving force behind his organization making ham radio happen. Well, making ham radio happen is big deal for a lot of very special people. And tonight we've got Roland Hoffman, Kilo Charlie 6, Juliet Papa Golf. He is the leader of the amateur television team. And as you're going to see and hear, with maybe a few echoes, because he's tied very elaborately in with Victor. They're tied into repeaters, YouTube, and who knows what else. But Roland, now, why don't you come on in on maybe the split screen? And Roland, good to have you on board. And we're going to show some short shots that Mike sent me, and then we'll get going with you. So there's our cue. Great. And Roland, what have we got for antennas up there? Go ahead, Roland.
Oh, right there, you're seeing Ord Mountain. And that's Mount Ord. That's located just south of Barstow and around the Apple Valley area. And what you're seeing is two of our link dishes. The dish, and that's Santa Barbara right there. That's our Santa Barbara link and our repeater system there. Rod, WB9KMO, he mans that station and does a great job for us. And so we have I think we only have one user right now in Santa Barbara. But that is definitely one of our links. There's our main, that's the hub of the amateur television network. That's Santiago Peak. And that's the rack system. It's up in the mezzanine up in the radio room. We got three racks. You can see on the right, that's our amplifiers and then our 220 repeater. And there's Mike and I believe a good friend from Arizona, and they went up to Ord Mountain and did a little 10 gig contesting. So a lot of fun. So it was a great time. That was up at Mount Potosi in Las Vegas, and they just hooked up the link dish from Mount Potosi, and that's going to be linked back to Ord Mountain to complete the link between California and Nevada. And so you see Mark and Mike and Kevin. Kevin lives in Las Vegas area. He's the trustee of the Mount Potosi repeater, the KB7VY repeater. And that's inside Mount Wilson. That's the Mount Wilson repeater site, and that serves the greater LA area. And it's, of course, all of our repeaters. There you go. That's our mascot. That's known as Mr. Wave. That's Mr. Wave Guide Snake. He guides us everywhere we go. So, Waveguide, we really appreciate you, my friend. Thank you very much for supporting all of us.
Wow. Well, you know, we've come a long way since we've been starting with amateur television. I go way back to Tom O'Hare and the little down converters and the analog. So, Roland, I understand that you've now got us tied into a host of amateur television network experts. We got Gary out there with the mobile communications van, and we got Don, and we've got a lot of experts. So, Roland, I'm going to let you go ahead. And we've got about 10 minutes to talk about what the Amateur Television Network has done to really make ham radio exciting, especially for kids. They're getting into this as well. So, Roland, take it away.
Well, very good. And Victor's going to help me out. He's going to patch in into our Santiago Peak repeater system that's live all the time, 24/7 on YouTube. And so there we go. And I'm going to drop my carrier. We're going to start with what we call Rocking Chair Dave, Dave Couch, KA6DPS. So Dave, say hi to everyone on Ham Nation.
Hi, everybody. This is Dave, KA6DPS. I'm in Riverside County, about 10 miles south of March Air Force Base.
And the best part about Dave is he's always there. Whenever I am doing a demonstration, television, and I want to show off the amateur television network.
Pass it over to Gary.
Is there
W6KVC? Gary, come on back, my friend, and he's got the ATV truck.
Hi, everybody. It's W6KVC and our amateur television mobile unit that we use for different club meetings and also can use in an emergency. It was donated to us, and it has everything. 2 gig transmitter, digital, and ready to go, multiple receivers. It has the mesh network system in it, and it's a real nice truck, and we really like it. And we also use it for the Microwave Society, which will be on tomorrow night. And you can also see that on YouTube. So back to you, Roland, W6KVC.
Very, very much for bringing the mobile ATN truck out. That is fantastic. Looking fabulous, my friend. And yes, we will be on the air with the San Bernardino Microwave Society, and that's tomorrow. And that's going to be at 7 o'clock Pacific Standard Time. Don't forget, we change our clocks to Sunday. and that's always an exciting event. We have at least about 20 to 25 people watching on the Amateur Television Network as well as on YouTube. And so it's a very, very exciting time. I'm going to go ahead and open up the repeater for anyone who wants to check in with the Ham Nation team. So come on in, my friends, on the Amateur Television Network repeater system, KC6JPG.
Hi, Roland and Annette. W6MAF. There was somebody else. That was Earl. Shooting a picture from Oak Hills, California. It's near Victorville, which is, recall, where they used to land the shuttles, about 45, 50 miles east of Edwards Air Force Base, up in the high desert of beautiful southern California. Anyway, back to the net, W6MAF.
Fantastic, Mark. Thank you very much for checking in, my friend. We're going to go ahead and pass it over to KJ6DQR. Earl, come on in, my friend. He's over in the Coachella Valley area, Cathedral City by Palm Springs. Earl, come on in.
Hello, everybody. Earl here in the Cathedral City Cove. I'm about 5 miles southeast of Palm Springs. Yeah, these guys are quite a group. I don't think there's anything in this group they can't build, make, repair, deploy, or figure out what's wrong with it RF-wise. So quite impressed with them. I've learned a lot over the years. I've been doing this about 9-10 years now. And if you want to take that next jump and do something a little bit harder, learn a little bit more, this is definitely the place to be.
Fantastic, Earl. Thank you very much.
Have a great week.
Thank you very much for participating with us on Ham Nation. This is fantastic. Also, we have a very, very special thing that we have on the Amateur Television Network. We have our online community. And I'm going to punch that up right now as we speak. And there you go. That's our online community. If you see it on the YouTube site, we check in from people from all over the world, yes. And so for those that don't have the opportunity to check in, you know, to have transmitters or not within the Amateur Television Network system, they're on vacation, they can check in with their tablets, their smartphones, their devices, their computers. And of course, if we start from the top left, that's me with my back. Hi. And then in the middle, we got Keith. He's over in the Yucca Valley area, N6GKB. And then, of course, we got Jim over in Pittsburgh, California, representing Mount Diablo in that K6SOE. He runs his nets on Thursday nights at 8 o'clock. And then down on the bottom left, we have Lee, K0CCU. He's our net control for Arizona for the White Tanks repeater system and also net control for Arizona. That's Bob, W8ARZ, and he's part of our Arizona team as well. So, and there you have it, my friends. And so we make it a lot of fun. We're getting into digital DATV. A lot of fun, let me tell you that. And I got something to show you real quick before I pass it back to Gordon. We got these little boxes here deployed at all of our ATV repeater sites. This is the HV110 receiver, and that is actually receiving our 434 megahertz DVB-T, the terrestrial version of digital television. We're actually transmitting 2 megahertz, and I'm using 16 QAM, and I'm actually going up 1280 by 720, and these will downscale to the proper scaling. And so it's working very, very well, very happy with it. And of course, with the transmitter side, let me grab that real quick. It's called an unboxing. That's what it's called. This is fresh from Hi-Dez. And so we have the HV202E, the ham version of this exciter. It is a 170 megahertz to 2500 megahertz. It runs on 2.4 as well. And so we're going to deploy these in our ATV truck and utilize the 2.4 amplifier and the dish. And we're going to have a 2.4 receiver up on Santiago. And so with the our shoots such as the San Bernardino Microwave Society, look out. We're coming. You got it. We're going to be transmitting digital. And so that's the exciting thing about it. You know, I'm not really a leader. I'm just simply part of this wonderful team that we all get together. And I mean, talk about, you know, the talent that we have in the amateur radio community. It is so much fun. And we all get together. We have meetings. We have our winter meetings. We have our summer meetings. There you go. Our online community right there. And we get together, we, you know, share ideas. Oh my gosh, it's just unlimited. It's just been an incredible ride. When I first started ATV real quick, all I wanted to do back in 1993 was to tune into Mount Wilson because they were showing NASA Select and watch the space shuttle. And well, guess what? When I put up my antenna and pointed towards Mount Wilson, well, I saw a stray signal off the lobe of my antenna, and it was a guy rocking in a chair. And I said to myself, who in the heck is that? And so here's what I'm going to do. Dave, come back and explain yourself. KC6JPG.
Well, I've been in a long time. I was in probably 2 or 3 days. I was monitoring HF, and two guys were talking. I stopped there because they said, well, I was kind of thinking about getting on that ATV, but all there is some old fart in a rocking chair.
Thank you. How can I put this? Thank you for inspiring me to get involved in amateur television, and it changed my life forever. And then I meet a guy named Mike Collis, WA6SVT. And let me tell you, we went from vestigial sideband and going into FM, 2.4 FM transmission. We thought that, wow, this is like, you know, high tech and all that. We put that in 1994. But here we are. Now we're getting into high definition television. So fantastic stuff that's coming for the amateur television network. So, Gordon, I'm going to pass it back to you, my friend. Thank you very, very much for the great opportunity to show what amateur television is all about.
Well, thank you, Roland. And wow, what a demo. And, you know, we get demos like that regularly. Roland, how about telling everybody, before we sign with this particular topic, if you would tell them all about our Tuesday evening, every Tuesday evening, where those here on Ham Nation can tune into our weekly net.
So every PM Pacific Standard Time, which will be daylight time next week. And if you're in Arizona, no problem. You'll be in the same time zone. It'll be 7:30 Mountain Standard Time in Arizona, but everywhere else will be 8:30, 9:30, 10:30. You join us on the Amateur Television Network's The Weekly Net. And we invite not just our ATVers from RF side, but we invite you to come on in and join us. I'm going to put up a graphic here. that you can join us, and we will check you in, our IP video check-ins. And it's on https://whereby.com/amateur TV network. And you can check in on the amateur television network. So if you're on vacation, if you don't have a transmitter yet, if you are not in within the amateur television network coverage area, that's no problem, because we are there on the whereby system, on the whereby.com system, and we will be on the mesh. So that's going to be very, very exciting. We have mesh on the truck. I have mesh here in the studio. We're going to be patching people in using mesh as well. So the technology is just blowing us away, and we are just loving it. So we would love for you to join us. And also, don't forget, DMR radio is hot. It is a very hot thing right now. And so if you join us on our talk group, which is 9410 ATV Talk, it is open to everybody. We talk about amateur television. We talk about when the nets are going to come on. We just simply just chat away. It is a lot of fun. And we would love for you to join us on DMR radio. You got it. As a matter of fact, there we are. I got my DMR radio. It's set for ATV Talk. Love to hear from you guys. So there you go. Like I said, every time I turn around, the technology is changing. And let me tell you, being hooked up onto DMR radio has just been a fantastic journey, because we got chapters that's located throughout the country. And now we can communicate with one another within DMR radio, as well as they check in with our weekly nets on Tuesday nights, 7:30 p.m. Pacific Standard and Daylight Time. And come and join us. We would love to have you. A lot of fun.
That is terrific. Well, Roland KC6, Juliet Papa Golf, Roland Hoffman, thank you for sharing your talent. Mike Collis, Mike maintains all of the commercial the commercial television stations up on Mount Wilson. And Dave, Rocking Chair Dave, is always there. Gary, my buddy, helps me out at Quartz Fest through the Mesh Network, and Don with the Mesh Network, getting all of the signal around the Quartz Fest site. Amateur television, a new frontier. Tune in. It's exciting. Thank you so much, Roland, and thanks to all of the other ATV operators that make this happen. Well, let's take a look on what's happening with ICOM America and their great HF, VHF, UHF products. ICOM America.
Get out and be active with ICOM's new IC705 and its optional multifunction backpack. The IC705 is your perfect QRP companion, as you have base station features and functionality at the tips of your fingers in a portable package covering HF, 6 meters, 2 meters, and 70 centimeters. This compact rig weighs in at 1 kilo, or just over 2 pounds, with RF direct sampling for most of the HF band and IF sampling for frequencies above 25 megahertz. 5-volt battery operation with BP272 or 10 watts with a 13.8-volt DC supply. Modes include single sideband, CW, AM, FM, as well as full D-Star functions. A large 4.3-inch color touchscreen and live band scope with waterfall. Integrated GPS with antenna and GPS logger. Micro SD card for data storage. It comes standard with the HM243 speaker microphone, and it supports QRP and QRPP operations. The perfect accessory for the IC705 is the LC192 optional backpack, with a special compartment for your IC705 and room for accessories for soda activations or just a day in the park. Visit ICOMAmerica.com/amateur for more information about this and all the great ICOM radios.
And ICOM invites you to enter weekly in the drawing for some great swag prizes like T-shirts and hats at ICOMAmerica.com/HamNation. And if you're one of the swag winners, you'll automatically be entered in the grand prize drawing each month for a new radio. And we've got our February winner here. It is Michael K5MRF, Michael Flanagan. Congratulations, Michael. You're going to enjoy that ICOM ID 4100A entry-level D-Star mobile with big rig features. But for March, we've got another radio standing by here. That is going to be, what is that? Looks like another ID 4100A entry-level D-Star mobile with big rig features, dual band, analog, and D-Star mobile, one band at a time, user-friendly interface for easier operation, built-in GPS, micro SD card slot for voice and data storage, optional Bluetooth board available, and there's downloadable Android and iOS apps available as well. So go to icomamerica.com/hamnation after this and each episode and register to win. Sign up, good luck, and don't forget to follow ICOM America, Inc. on Facebook and Twitter. And tonight, for Smoke and Solder, I just had a couple of things I wanted to take a look at here. One is actually, I'm going to call it an unboxing, although it's partially out of the box, it's not completely, and I have not looked at it yet, and then I want to show you a neat wire trick as well. The first thing, though, is going to be the ARRL Antenna Book, and I'm sure, you know, a lot of you have seen that book over the years. Well, it's in the 24th edition now. They just published it. It's available in three different configurations. You can get it in a soft cover. You can get a digital download of the digital version of it, or it's available as a limited edition 4-volume boxed set. And that's what this is right here. You remember that new box set that I showed you several months back on the Amateur Radio Handbook? They've done that to the antenna book as well now. So you get 4 volumes in here, all boxed up. Pull them out here and look at them. They're stacked backwards because of the nature of things. There. Antenna Fundamentals is volume number 1. There's information in these books, new coverage of small transmitting loops, new and expanded coverage of microwave antennas, new MF, HF, and 6-meter antenna design articles, introductions to and how to acquire HF TA terrain profiles online, an overview of VHF and UHF rover antennas, a new chapter on VHF and UHF antenna systems, rotator ratings, installation and maintenance, updating transmitter chokes and design and selection for updated ground system analysis, and detailed sets of ground conductivity maps. Just about everything you want to know about antennas is in here. And you know, it doesn't really matter how much power you're running. If you don't have a good antenna, you know, you're not getting the signal where you want it to be. And these books right here are a great resource for learning more about antennas, how to build them, how they operate. As I mentioned, I have not been through them yet. Let's just skim through a couple of them here. Volume 1 starts out, and, you know, if you get the book, either the softbound version or the box set here, in the very front of it, there's going to be a coupon code in here that you can use to download the digital version as well. So you've got it available on your computer as well as the printed edition here, like a number of the ARRL books. Antenna impedance, we're just going to skim through a lot of antenna radiation patterns there for different types of antennas, different plots on ground loss, you know, just all kinds of good information in here on antennas. And there, right there, I downloaded my copy last night and saved it to a DVD, so I've got the backup there. These books will really clue you into what's going on with antennas. Volume 2 is antennas for low frequency, medium frequency, and high frequency. And of course, this will cover the AM broadcast band on either side of it, below it and above it, because, you know, now we've got a couple of bands down there that are very low, down below the AM broadcast bands. This tells you how to make some creative designs, because those antennas are often, well, usually if you made it a full wavelength or a quarter wave, it's going to be too large for a lot of people. So you got to come up with good alternate ideas on how to pull that off. And they've got some in here on how to make antennas that will operate on those bands without having to be the full-length vertical radiator sticking up in the air. A lot of different good antenna designs, omnidirectional as well as directional. And there is not an index in the back of each book. You know, the reason they didn't do it that way, because you don't know what book you want to look in to find something. Volume 4 here, transmission line and building antenna systems and the index. So, you know, you got to get the power to the antenna. This book covers that. But here in the back is a comprehensive index of everything that's in all of these books. And so this will tell you right here which chapter you want to look in. And, you know, each book covers a certain number of chapters here. That way you'll know which book to look in. If you're using the box set here, of course, all of these chapters would be in the softbound edition just as a single book. But the index right there, we didn't talk about volume 3. Let's do that real quick. Antennas for VHF through microwave and specialty antennas. We're going to look a little closer at these one day, and maybe more than one day, because there's so many different antenna ideas in here that I was not aware of, and I'm sure a lot of you are not either. Stealth and limited space antennas, so some great ideas there for you people who got HOAs you got to deal with or a limited amount of space. Some great ideas here that actually work. Look at that. That looks kind of like a spider beam. I don't know if you can see it in the picture. But it also looks kind of like a clothesline that you might get away with. So, good idea there. But great information there. Now, this is probably, if not the best, one of the best antenna sources out there as far as reference and knowing how an antenna operates and how to build one that, you know, will perform well for you within the constraints that you have to deal with. The ARRL Antenna Book, I'm going to have a fun time looking at that, and who knows, maybe I'll come up with some better antenna designs than I've got right now, because I'm not able to get on 160 meters. I need to do something about that. I'm sure there's going to be a design in that book that'll work for me right there. And I promised you a wire trick here. I don't know if you really call this a trick, but let's look at this right here. I ran across this years ago in a broadcast audio console I was working on. And this console was fairly old. It was built back in the days before they had heat shrink tubing. And some of the wire in there was, if it'll focus, kind of like this right here. You know, there's a jacket on the wire, and then it looked like a thicker piece of insulation here on the end where you would normally use heat shrink tubing. And then the stripped wires came out there. Now, you know, that works like heat shrink tubing right there, except it's certainly a lot tougher. And makes a lot better stress relief. Well, I'm going to show you how to do that. No, I'm not going to say throw out your heat shrink tubing. But there are certain occasions where I do this trick rather than use a piece of heat shrink, just because it's more durable. And I know it's going to work better in the application I got. So I've already scored this wire here so I can break off the jacket with that blade there, but pull the jacket off. And yeah, this is a four conductor It's actually two shielded pairs in there. This, you know, works great for stereo or certain data applications. So I've got two pair of wires here as well as a drain wire, or, you know, that's what's connected to the shield on it. And it's stripped back here. Of course, the foil insulation is up under there because I pulled it off. But the way we do this, that insulation that I pulled off, we just decide how much of that we want to use. Cut off a little bit of it there. Take a set of needle nose pliers, and yes, this is more trouble than doing heat shrink, but really, it's not much more trouble. This won't work with every type of wire jacket that's out there, but these plastic types, this is a belting cable right here, it works really good with them. So we just keep sliding that on there, stretching this a little bit more with our needle nose pliers by opening them up. And we'll hold it there a moment so that it kind of gets a memory to this. Now, this insulation is going to spring back into its original size, but it's going to take it a few seconds to do that. So I hold it out here a little while. When I'm ready to slide it down over here, I take it out of the pliers there, feed my wires through it, push it right up there over the regular jacket. And now it's already started shrinking down to it. It's there. And it's a very good cover there on the end of the wire. It's thicker, you know, as far as a stress relief. It is much stronger. You're not going to break this like you might do on some heat shrink tubing. But I use this anytime that, well, like this quarter inch phone connector here. You know, these things are made where you slip the wire through here and then you crimp that down. And of course, you slide the cover over the end of the jacket or the end of the connector there. Well, when you crimp that down right there, if you've just got a piece of heat shrink tubing, you know, that'll work. But that heat shrink really doesn't add much durability to that cable. If you do this right here, and then you crimp down on that, then you're going to have, it's essentially double insulation out here as a stress relief coming out of that connector. And it's going to be much harder to break, much more durable. So anyway, that's just a cheap wire trick there I wanted to show you. I'm not going stingy on the heat shrink, but, you know, sometimes you just don't have any heat shrink with you, and you need to do something to kind of prep the wire that you're working with. This is a good trick. We'll work with a lot of different kinds of cables, and why not? You know, if you got it, you got the needle nose pliers, you can do that pretty quick. And as I say, it's much more durable than heat shrink. Once it shrinks down, it doesn't want to come back off of there. So there you go. Cheap wire trick. And now, let's see, I think Don has an important announcement here. We've all been waiting to hear how, this is one of the big contests of the year, I would say here. It's not really a contest, it's an award. I was fortunate enough to win one of these a number of years ago, as well as Bob has and Gordo has. It's a really special honor. Tell us what it is, Don.
Yeah, very, very prestigious. These are the Hamvention 2020 award winners, and this is just very prestigious. I'm very, very thrilled to tell you who the club of the year is. That's the South Canadian Amateur Radio Society in Oklahoma, where I grew up, and I met these guys when I went to the Oklahoma City Hamfest a couple of years ago. Great people. W5NOR.org is the website. Really, really enjoyed hanging out with the guys in the South Canadian Amateur Radio Society. And I get their newsletter every week. Really good reading. Very good people. So congratulations to the folks in the Scars Club. Very, very cool. The biggie, of course, amateur of the year. No surprise here. Zorro, J-H-1-A-J-T. If you don't know who Zorro is, you're not a DXer, because this guy is world class as far as DXing. He has won so many awards. Just congratulations to you, Zorro, J-H-1-A-J-T. Technical Achievement Award, given to a selected radio amateur who has achieved technical excellence in the world of amateur radio. The 2020 Technical Achievement Award goes to Steve Frank, K9AN, Bill Somerville, G4WJS, and Joe Taylor, K1JT. Of course, you know who Joe Taylor, K1JT, is if you do JT65 or FT8. WSJTX, that is his project. Of course, FT8, FT4, just great stuff. Those guys have all been, those three, in fact, have been licensed for a combined total of 154 years. Talk about a brain trust. Those are the guys who have brought you all of that FT8 and WSJT and everything else. So congratulations to you guys. Special Achievement Award. This is Jordan Scherer, KN4CRD. He's a software engineer by day, digital amateur radio operator by night, and the JS8 call is his baby. So very, very cool. Congratulations to all of you guys. Of course, they'll all be honored at Hamvention 2020, and it's just going to be a great time out there. So congratulations to all of the Hamvention 2020 award winners. Want to say hello to our friends over at WTWW. They're, you know, they're in Lebanon, Tennessee, which is in the Nashville area, and they're okay. I texted Ted Randall and the gang over there, so they're all okay. So thank goodness. And they, of course, huge friends of Ham Nation and of Amateur Radio Newsline and of ham radio in general. Info at WTWW.us is the email if you'd ever like to send them some good stuff. So check them out. WTWW, great shortwave radio station here in the U.S. Yeah, shortwave's going strong. And in fact, you can listen to Ham Nation Audio simulcast live right now on WTWW. Just the best. All right, then, now that we've got the news of the Hamvention 2020 award winners out, let's go ahead and get into the rest of the news of the week from Amateur Radio Newsline. From Amateur Radio Newsline Report number 2209, these are the Ham Nation headlines for Wednesday, March 4th, 2020. First up, Newsline anchor Jim Dameron, N8TMW, tells of challenges facing the VP8 PJ South Orkney Islands de-expedition team.
The radio operators who expect to remain there until March 6th have only had limited success with satellite connections, even from the ship, restricting the regular uploading of logs. Team member Gene, K5GS, writes Newsline from the island, quote, "We've been in contact with the service provider and we all agree that the problem is the terrain and the satellite's low angle in the sky," end quote. Meanwhile, Gene said uploads will be done whenever possible. The team asks hams refrain from emailing pilots about whether they made it through the pileups into the log. He writes, quote, "This is an experienced de-expedition and contest team. If you hear them repeat your call, you're in the log," end quote. He added, "Have patience." The South Orkney Islands are the 16th most wanted DX entity listed on Club Log.
National regulators on the island of St. Kitts have been called in to help contain interference the local utility company has caused hams on that island.
The St. Kitts, Nevis, Anguilla Amateur Radio Society has been locked in an ongoing battle over RF interference, jamming, and noise. But the group's nemesis hasn't been a problematic ham or group of hams. It's been the so-called smart meters installed by the electric company on the island of St. Kitts. Smart meters keep track of a customer's use of electric energy and relay the data to the utility for billing and monitoring purposes. The leadership of the Radio Society has plans to meet with the National Telecommunications Regulatory Commission, or NTRC, within the next few weeks to attempt to resolve the issue. The hams are receiving guidance and support, meanwhile, from officials at Region 2 of the International Amateur Radio Union. Despite the fact that the NTRC sent the electric company a cease and desist order more than 4 months ago, St. Kitts hams continue to report issues on 40 and 80 metres. there are no smart meters on the island of Nevis. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm John Williams, VK4JJW.
Something arrived recently on the International Space Station from the UK, and it'll make communications home that much easier for the astronauts.
Thanks to a recent special delivery to the International Space Station, astronauts will be able to make contact with their families and with scientists using home broadband speeds. A communications antenna manufactured by MDA UK was delivered to the ISS earlier this month aboard a Cygnus freighter and marks the UK's first industrial contribution to the ISS. In just a few weeks, the antenna will be installed on the outside of Europe's ISS science module, where it's expected to help deliver improved radio links. It will route video, voice and data to the ground, making use of satellites that are actually higher in the sky than the ISS. David Kenyon, the managing director of MDA UK based in Oxfordshire, told the BBC that for now communications from Columbus will continue to go through the American data relay satellites. He noted, however, that those satellites are prioritised for US use. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jeremy Boot, G4NJH.
And a reminder that the nominating period for the 2020 Bill Pasternak WA6ITF Newsline Young Ham of the Year Award is now open. You'll find the form on our website, arnewsline.org, under the YHOTY tab. The award will be presented Saturday, August 22nd at the Huntsville Hamfest in Alabama. And that's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline, your independent source for amateur radio news for four decades and counting at arnewsline.org. With Jim Dameron, N8TMW, John Williams, VK4JJW, Jeremy Boot, G4NJH, Karen Eve Murray, KD2GUT at the news desk in New York, and our news team across the globe. I'm Don Wilbanks, AE5DW. 73. We'll see you next time here on Ham Nation. All right. Great stuff from the Newsline team. We appreciate all the effort that they put into that so that we can bring that to you. Dr. T has been busy all day, but she did not have time to produce a video, but she does have some information for us in the form of some slides and stuff that words that she's putting into my mouth, which I will now put into your ear. Solar storm and an aurora outlook. We have a weak Earth-directed solar storm that should hit Earth sometime around the 7th and 8th, although the storm is pretty weak. We could see aurora at high altitudes with a weak possibility of aurora dipping down to mid-latitudes. However, things should calm down as we move towards midweek. Moving to the solar flare and radiation storm outlook, the two regions that we're keeping our eyes on last week have fizzled, so we're back into the low 70s for solar flux. That means we'll hover around the lower hairy edge for marginal conditions and radio propagation conditions on Earth's day side this week. Unfortunately, we don't see any bright regions in stereo's view either, so these conditions could last easily through the end of next week before things begin to improve. Of course, you should follow her on Twitter, at Tamitha Scove, and of course, right there, spaceweatherwoman.com. Everything you need to know about space weather, distilled down into a form that even I can understand. And if I can understand it, I know you can too. And speaking of understanding, we have Amanda who is watching the chat room, and I understand that she may have some questions for all of us.
Yes, I do. Good evening, everybody. My first announcement, though, is that even though Newsline and VP8PJ said that they were going to wrap up on the 6th, they're going to leave on the 6th. They're actually leaving on the 7th now due to conditions are going to be better for them to go out to the ship and things like that. So look for them one extra day. Yeah.
Oh, good.
Everybody. I finally got them good. In the logs. I was really, Jeff and I both. Me, second try. Jeff, like 25 tries later. He's getting
well, that's
dirty,
the YL but. Effect.
It is kind of the YL effect. And they sounded, that was the one and only time we have heard them in the last 10 days that they've been operating or whatever. So it was kind of a miracle and good for all of you all that got them in the logs. I don't know what their final total is going to be, but I'm going to guess around, I'll estimate 65,000. Okay.
Wow.
They were working it hard. Gordo, so we got some ATV questions. Roland couldn't stay around because we had to have the open slot here, but I bet you can answer some of these for us. First of all, give us kind of a total cost of what it would cost to get into the amateur television.
If you're working Amanda, a swap meet, and I know that we all have great swap meets, you can many times find PC electronics transmitters that are on the 70 centimeter band for $100, less than that, and the down converters, which we showed you a few minutes ago, for like $40. But the high definition is what a lot of folks are going to, and Roland tells me, give him an email, and he'll give you the details. Now, Roland's email address for questions regarding the amateur television network and the equipment is his call sign, Kilo Charlie 6 Juliet Papa Golf at charter.net. So in ballpark figures, it's about $1,000 for a power amplifier, as well as the modulator and all of the other gear, as well as the demodulator for seeing the picture for digital amateur television. So I suggest that check around and see what is happening on ATV in the area. And if everybody's going digital, then let's find out where the best deal is. And I'll tell you, Roland knows because he showed one tonight. Amanda?
Absolutely. So that brings me kind of to my next question. How much equipment do you need? You're talking modulators, power amplifiers. Kind of rattle it off there for us, Gordo, to give us a heads up.
All right. Well, my equipment is a 2.4 gigahertz transmitter, thanks to Mike Collis. They got me started with that. Conifer dish antenna and the PC electronics down converters to either an analog or a digital TV with an analog receiver. And I probably got $1,000 in it. So like a relatively mid-priced HF radio. That's what it takes to get into ATV for gear. But the big deal is the signal strength to the local repeater, or if you plan to just do ATV locally, you might even invest in only a couple $100 with small little home television cameras and the mesh network that we still have permission on at 3.5 gigs. I don't know how much longer we're going to hold that band. So it's not a huge expense, certainly not over a grand. It's just a lot of fiddling, as you saw tonight.
Absolutely. And Victor worked really hard at making that work for all of us to see the demonstration. Now, just speaking of that, you brought up the 3.5 gigs, so I'm going to bring it up briefly. Is it easy for you all to switch your mesh over to the 5.8?
It will be new equipment, and okay. I'll let Roland give you the official word on that. But no, it's going to take a new type of router. Now, if you have a router with both 2, 3, and 5, then it might be more easy. But even the 5 gigahertz band is under the scrutiny of the FCC for, quote, underused. Yet we're serving police departments and public safety officials with ham radio video, as well as direct connections on 5 gigs. So we really, as hams, need to continue our push to keep our microwave bands. And let me tell you, Amanda, the Amateur Television Network is really pushing hard for the microwave bands.
I bet they are. And we are, too. We have our microwave network here in all of Colorado, connecting even to New Mexico and up into Cheyenne, Wyoming. And it's all on. Oh, and yes, that's part of Colorado. And we're using the 5.8, and same thing with our microticks and things like that. We're really sweating if they want to start looking into giving those bandwidths away. So, Gordo, thank you so much. The other thing, I saw a lot of comments on chat, and you're going to see this later tonight when I send it to you, but everyone was really impressed with this amateur television network and these nets. The only thing I would say is we're kind of disappointed they didn't show more of that van off. We'd like to see the inside of that. How about a tour sometime?
All right. Well, I'll relay that to Gary, who is the owner-operator of the com van with ATV. It's got a pneumatic mast. And I mean, Gary has spent a ton of time, and I'll let him know that on our next one, maybe about 30 days from now, we want to both address the chat room that you've been monitoring so cautiously and carefully for those great comments. And number two, we want an inside look inside that van. He's really got it tricked out. Gary is a great guy.
That's right. We want it. We want to see the antennas installed on top of it, and we want to see the inside of it. So, Gordo, I do have another comment. Remember, I had mentioned our A4S went kooky on us last week, and we wanted to get it fixed in time for the contest. So, Jeff, bless his heart, I'm still giving him massages because he had to hike up there and stay up there for so long. Anyhow, we did finally end up lowering the driven element, and it did need some maintenance. Some of the traps were a little bit loose. There were some broken grommets in there. Jeff went to put it back up after we'd fixed those things. And here I am. I'm talking on the radio, and I'm tuning up on the radio, still SWR like crazy. And we're so disappointed, and we're thinking, we've just wasted our whole weekend trying to fix this thing. Finally, Jeff looks at the vapor wrap on the connectors and realizes that somehow, from an act of unnatural circumstances, moisture and things did get in there. So he's up there and he's taking feed line from our UHF and VHF antennas and unwrapping all of them as well. Finally found a good connector, and voila! We have an A4S again that works.
Terrific. That is great.
It is great. It, obviously, we're just going to have to spend some more time up there replacing some things, but it's going to work for the contest this weekend, which is a huge one, everyone. You know, the ARRL DX contest, you don't want to miss out. It starts Friday evening. My timer, I think, of 6 p.m. Anyhow, get on the air, make those contacts. You can almost finish out your DXCC in one weekend with that. Gordo, you going to play?
Oh, absolutely. I'll be there with just a little A4, but I'll try and squeak out 100 watts all over the world.
Oh, there you go. Well, if the bands work for us, and Don, do you ever get into those DX contests?
No, I don't. I like DX. I like hunting it occasionally. I never have time to get on the radio. The most I've spent on the radio this year, probably the last 2 years, was when we did the Bill Pasternak WA6ITF activation a few weeks ago. And I've got a big stack of QSL cards about that thick that we've been sending out. So if you made contact with WA6ITF, send that QSL card in with an SASE. We'll get the Newsline QSL card back to you. But one of these days, I'm going to break down and get into contesting or DXing or something, because it's fascinating to me. It really is.
The North American QSO party is probably going to be one of your funnest ones, because almost everyone runs 100 watts.
So yeah, I'm going to have to try that.
I got like the big guns that you have to fight against.
We got wild for field day one year. Myself and Joe Pardue. Joe was actually logging for me, and we did the first 3 hours, I think, of field day one year. And we were averaging, I want to say, probably, oh gosh, I don't know, probably 5 contacts a minute. I mean, we were cranking them up. Yeah, we were cranking them up.
That's really good.
And we actually got about 70% of the whole 24 hours of contacts just in those 3 hours.
Wow.
And
that's
amazing. Fun.
That's fun. Really rough. I bet your ears were bleeding afterwards.
The adrenaline. The adrenaline. I was like, this is what it's like. And so ever since then, I kind of want to try that again. So yeah, one of these
do
things.
Do it. Just do it. And you know who my nemesis always is, everyone? You viewers out there, don't tell Valerie this, but she is my nemesis. She beats those pileups. I hear her in the contest. I'm cruising up and down, trying to see who I can hear and who I can work. And whose beautiful voice do I always hear? November Victor 9 Lima. She does so awesome. And they pick her out. Well, boom, instantly.
Great. You know what it is? It's not only is it the YL effect of the female voice, but it's also that monster station that she has.
She does. She has a monster station.
Yeah, she does.
That antenna farm is something else. But George, what about you? You going to get on the contest this weekend?
You know, I might try it. I haven't worked any contest in, well, I'm not going to say how long. It has been quite a while. I do field day every year, and I always enjoy that. But, you know, they say that's not a contest. I'm more of a rag chewer, but I do like to operate DX. I haven't done much of that lately either. Like Don, I've just been too busy to get on the air. But, you know, I'm hoping to get on the air more very soon. And as a matter of fact, when I just heard about that extension through tomorrow, I might try to work those guys before they pack up and go home.
I think I'm going to try that tomorrow night, too.
They've been on FT8 quite a bit. And they've been on some really weird bands, honestly. But when they're operating on 17, I'm just like, why? Just go to 20. Come on, help us all out here. But they really have been in on every band, every mode a lot. So good luck, you guys, on that. And George, I'm just going to put this out there. I think you like field day, and I think you like making the contacts, but I think you and Tommy have more fun putting the camp together and getting your antennas up.
Well, you know, anytime you can use Visqueen and duct tape on a project, you know you've got a fun weekend. Of course, if you don't air condition the tent, it's too hot to do it down here for us. But we always have a big time at field day. And, yeah, going through the motions of setting up the campsite, setting up all the antennas and equipment, making everything work is as much fun for us as actually making the contacts.
Yeah. You just need to find a quieter generator.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I really do.
I want to tell my field day story because it's been a while since I've told it. This is a great memory of field day that I have. I'm sure we have some new viewers since I've told it last. This was with the Westside Amateur Radio Club in the New Orleans area. We were putting wire antennas up in a park. And they were off-center fed dipoles, 80-meter off-center fed dipoles. And we couldn't find anything to weight the end of the rope to throw up into the tree so that we could pull the wire back over. And Steve, N5SC, great, great friend, excellent amateur radio operator, he gets the brilliant idea. Well, wait a minute. Let me just tie this jar of pickles around the thing. Because, you know, as soon as it goes over the tree, I'll grab the rope and it'll swing down and it'll be perfect. Well, it's just like the perfect pitch in baseball or the perfect throw of a football from the quarterback's hand or the perfect, if you've ever bowled, and as soon as the ball has left your hand, you know immediately it's going right into the pocket and it's going to blow all the pins back into the pit. No, as soon as that jar of pickles left his hand, you could telegraph the arc. It went right over, completely missed the tree, and dropped right down in the middle of the asphalt jogging path. Pickles everywhere. Pickle relish, I think it was. Pickle relish everywhere.
Oh, wow.
And then there was the time that they were hanging antennas up in a thunderstorm, three extra-class radio operators all around a six-foot aluminum ladder, hanging wire antennas up and lightning crashing all around us. So, yeah, it's memories of field day with the Westside Club.
We're going to talk about safety in field day, you guys.
Yeah. Yeah. Some people need a refresher, clearly.
Because Don just scared the heck out of me. So, in a lightning storm. Okay. All right. Let's wrap it up here.
I have a picture of that ladder. If I can find that, I'll dig it out for next week. Somewhere I have a picture of the guys on that ladder.
We don't want to see it.
I want to see the ladder. I'd like to see the three guys that actually thought it was a good idea to go out there on the ladder during the storm.
No one ever said it was a good idea, but it's field day.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Again, field day safety, main priority for Ham Nation coming up in May. Okay. All right. Nets. So we have the D-Star net going on currently on 14 Charlie. We have the DMR net on 31012. And Steve, this is right. Steve, I think, is out with his wife for anniversary dinner. So W7UDI will not be running the 75-meter net. Happy anniversary, you two happy couple. And look for Kevin on 7192 if band conditions are existing, which they have not been at this time of night. on 40 for a while now. So anyone who does manage to check in, kudos to you because it's been rough. All right, that's all I have. Don, do your thing.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm not going to be operating the radio tomorrow Saturday because, well, I'm doing this. Going up to the Pine Belt Ham Fest in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. If you just, there's no website listed on here, really. So if you just Google Pine Belt, oh, did you find it? Oh, well, there it is right there. Wow. Look at Victor go.
Victor is awesome.
That's pretty much all you need to know. It's up in Hattiesburg, Mississippi at the Forest County Community Shelter. 146-775 is the talk-in with a 136.5 PL. But, of course, if you just listen, you'll hear everything you need to. I'm excited about heading up to that. So we'll do that.
And, yeah, you'll have to do a Google search. I think the site,
yeah.
The site isn't,
yeah.
isn't easy to
see. No, it's not. But that just Google Pine Belt Ham Fest Hattiesburg, and that's what you'll find. And, of course, there ain't no burg like Hattiesburg. So it should be a good time. So let's send it back around and see for parting thoughts. George, anything to add tonight?
Oh, you're muted, George.
I believe they call Hattiesburg the hub city.
Yes, they do.
I may try to come down there, Don. I hadn't planned on it, but I'll have to see what's going on this weekend. If it doesn't stop raining, I may just float down there.
But weather's supposed to
anyway,
be nice.
Yeah. The thunder and lightning still going on out here in the rain. You probably heard the rain a little earlier when I did that segment because, the studio's got a metal roof out here and it kind of gets loud in here. Anyway, fun show tonight. We'll see you all next week. And, wow, yeah, get on the air some. Don't be like me. Get on the air some.
Absolutely. And like me, too. Yeah. I'm the world's worst. Gordon, you're always on the air. What's going on? Any far parting words?
Victor, I'm okay. I'm just messing with you. Wow.
This is George
parting
impression.
Words. Wow.
I was going to let you finish first and then tell you.
What a night to pull all of this off. And thanks, viewers and listeners and shortwave listeners, for tuning us in. And I've lost my voice. See you all next week. And about a month from now, we'll do another special on the Amateur Television Network.
Thanks again. And it was a wonderful, wonderful show. We really appreciate it. All of our ATVers and ATN members had a great, great time. If you want more information about the Amateur Television Network, come on over. Come on over to our website. You got it. Well, that's our IP video check-ins right there. Well, there's our YouTube site. You can watch our repeater systems 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Santiago Peak Repeater is on the W6ATN. W7ATN is over at White Tank in Arizona. And you can watch us, youtube.com/amateur television network. You got it. And, of course, our website, www.atn-tv.org. You can get more information about our repeater systems and want to be involved with amateur television, how to get involved with amateur television. We would love answering questions about it. I mean, let me tell you, it's just a whole different realm of amateur radio because when you actually see the person, it becomes not just scary but a lot of fun because you never know what's coming up next. And that's like that on live TV every day. And that's what we do here on Amateur Television Network. So Gordon and Don and George and everyone on the Ham Nation team, thank you again. It was a lot of fun. We really enjoy it. And we want to say 7-3 and take care. And we will see you on the air. KC6JPG, we're clear.
Thank you, Victor. Amazing what he can do. Victor up at the Twit Studio, number one mix man. Don?
Yeah, and your pro tip for the night, never think parting words, but say final words because it's.
I do have one more thing, if you don't mind me making a small announcement.
What is it?
Okay.
What is it?
Always so we wanted to have this guest on last week with Ray Novak, and this is a pretty special milestone to hit. I would like to talk about Al Loesch, N3FKE. And he's going to be running his 400th consecutive Western Pennsylvania D-Star Net on Reflector 63 Charlie. That's going to be March 9th. Can you imagine? This man has been into D-Star probably since it first came out. And he's been running this net. And this is going to be his 400th. So everybody, we invite you to join in on March 9th. At, I'm trying to find the time here. Please stand by. 2100 hours Eastern time. So make sure you join in there and tell him, great job. Thanks for running this net. Anything, just check in and let him know he's fantastic. And Ray Novak was just blown away that this guy has ran 400 nets. Never missed a one. So Al, thank you for your dedication, I guess, is the only word I can say. That's pretty awesome, and that's a lot of nets. So that's all I had. Okay, thanks. Back to you, Don.
Awesome, thanks. Well, everybody, we'll see you. Those of you who are going to come down to Hattiesburg, we'll see you in Hattiesburg, and the rest of you, we'll see you here next week right here on most of this same Twit Network. So for the what do they call us? The unindicted co-conspirators? Dr. Bob, hopefully will be back next week, and I'm gonna check out and head that way. So, we'll see you guys next week here on Ham Nation. Good night, everybody. We appreciate you.